So my talk for today is identity management for the next decade. So basically, what I'm going to talk about is what you should expect in a typical identity and access management systems, and what are the currently kind of trending areas or trending technologies in those different areas, and what we can expect in the future, right? So if you are talking about how the future is going to look like, we should sink in with these three disrupting forces, I would call it. So the mobile, the social, and the cloud. So for that matter, these three forces are disrupting the complete middleware. But when we talk about identity, these three are quite important. When we say mobile, we are talking about the different devices, right? So we know that for a fact that the internet usage of mobile devices, such as the mobile phones or the other handheld devices, have surpassed the usage of PCs, right? So mobile is becoming more and more a B2B device rather than a a consumer device kind of. When we talk about social, we are talking about the different type, the different kinds of users, right? So earlier we had to only deal with internal users, users who are in our organization. But now we are talking about how we are going to give secured access to users coming from outside, like our partners, our consumers, our customers, leads, and so on, right? And then cloud also brings on its own challenges, right? Earlier, we only used to deploy systems on-premise, but now we have different deployment options like public clouds, private clouds, and hybrid clouds. And traditionally, there has been a thinking that cloud is not suited for IAM, but it seems like nowadays, people see that the advantages outweigh the disadvantages. So let's talk a bit about that also in later slides. So there are these two camps of thinking, user-centric identity and enterprise-centric identity. So what is user-centric identity? So it's actually Kim Cameron, who's a Microsoft identity expert, who came up with this term. So what he says is it should not be possible to automatically link up everything we do in all aspects of how we use the internet. A single identifier that stitches everything up would have many unintended consequences. So what he says is when we are sharing our identity to other applications, there should not be a notion of a single unified identity. There should be a single unified identity, but when we are sharing it, we should not share the identity, but we should share personas of those that identity, right? So for different applications, we should share different personas, a different profile for each application. And also, we should have the control to revoke that access to that persona, right? So this is what he's saying. And then there is this other camp of experts who talk about enterprise-centric identity, right? The whole enterprise has a single unified identity, and that's in your like corporate user store and stuff like that. But today we see the user-centric identity is winning, right? So the user is in control of his identity. He decides which persona to share, and he decides when to revoke access to it. So this is actually winning. Also, we come to see that bring your own identity concept, which is also a realization of this user-centric identity concept. So whenever you go to a new website today, we don't give username and passwords to create an account. We give either email address, or we give either your Facebook credentials, Google credentials. So this is the bring your own identity concept, a single identity for everything. And then identity consumerization is also another important thing, right? So we see that more and more, with even some countries, they are giving a uniquely identifiable ID for all their citizens. Countries like US and UK have these different programs where they are trying to give a unique identifier for all their citizens, and their citizens can use these identifiers to do online transactions, access different government services. So even WSO to IIS is used in such a way in Dubai for their Dubai e-government project. So this is also another dimension of user-centric identity. So what we can expect is that in future, we won't see a lot of corporate directories of users and accounts. There'll be like a single repository, and we would always rely for authentication on that repository, right? Then mobile usage also brings in its own challenges. So it was reported in 2014 that the mobile usage of internets has surpassed the PCs and the traditional desktops, right? And the worldwide sales of mobile devices is 10 times that of PCs and desktops, right? If you see that people are using mobiles for B2B transactions more and more, right? So this shows you the percentage of how much of mobile devices are used in workplaces, right? If you see that purple color graph there, 69 to 71% say they use mobile devices, such as iPads and mobile phones, for B2B transactions during working hours. Of course, you would expect during commuting hours, they use more mobile devices. But of course, that's not for B2B purposes. They might be doing something else, like chatting, you know, socializing and stuff like that. So the cloud. So traditionally, there has been some resistance to go into the cloud because of, you know, security, privacy concerns. But there are some advantages that people are realizing now in cloud, right? Obviously, the key advantage is that it's cost effective, right? You're a business and you want to focus on your competitive advantage. You don't want to deal with, you know, identity and access management stuff. There are experts to deal with that. So that's why you would go to a cloud-based identity and access management solution. And, you know, the capacity planning is easy, right? There, you know, there are these seasonal peaks and, you know, seasonal lows. So you can, there's flexibility in the capacity planning, right? And automated backup and recovery, you don't need to care about those stuff. You can downsize your IT department or your identity access management department, for that matter. And these are some advantages, of course. Then the second one is very, very important when it comes to IAM, I think, because identity access management is right now is a very rapidly evolving area, right? There is nothing constant. It's shifting every day. So if you have like an on-premise system, it's very hard for you to upgrade it or, you know, install patches and stuff like that. So this is also a realization that we have come across like inside WSO2. So we are also kind of thinking of, you know, changing our packaging strategy and changing our release models and so on and so forth. So cloud really, you know, cloud really helps do this stuff much easier. Then the standardization. So a lot of standards are there right now. So it's not that hard to, you know, migrate from an on-premise deployment to a cloud deployment. And also, like, cloud handles the SaaS applications more effectively than on-premise deployments, like, you know, multi-tenancy and elastic scaling and stuff like that. So these are like the typical functions of an IAM system. It's not an exhaustive list, but generally this is what you would find in an IAM system. So I will just walk you through each and every one of these very briefly. So what are the trends we are seeing in authentication, right? So we've had username password all this time. We are still using it. It has its disadvantages, drawbacks, but it's still a very good primitive, you know, identification for a user, right? So the first step of authentication can be username and password. You can give a limited set of resource access to him. But whenever you need to give privileged resources access to him, you need to step up the authentication, right? So you would have experience, like, if you are logging into like banking sites, the first step would be username and password. You can browse, do stuff. But when you are going to do a critical transaction, then they would require you to authenticate with a, you know, key fob or something like that. So that is step-up authentication. Then adaptive authentication, right? Based on the environment, the user is required for a further authentication step. For example, if you are using services like Google, whenever you log in from home, you just get single sign-on. But when you change your location where you log in from, based on that environmental information, Google prompts you with a second factor authentication. Then another example would be like, this also deals with some fraud detection stuff. So if you're like typing in your passwords, right, you have an average speed that you would type in your passwords. But if, for example, a bot is trying to carry out an attack, or another, you know, attacker is trying to do the same thing, then his speed of typing the password might be, you know, way, way different from the average speed. So in that case, it can intelligently prompt you to give a second factor authentication. So we've seen different ways of second factor authentication, like smartphones, key fobs, QR code scanners. Right now, I think smartphones and authenticator tools are the widely used ones because of the accessibility, right? But Fast Identity Online Alliance is an alliance that has brought in standards for standardizing the two-factor authentication space. and it's already a standard, but the adoption is still very low. It's quite new. So actually, Identity Server 5.2, 5.1.0 actually has support for FIDO. So what can we tell about authorization? So Gartner predicted by 2020, 70% of businesses will use attribute-based access control. That is true. Attribute-based access control is on the rise, right? And environmental or context-based access control is also on the rise. So how do we define authorization policies? So if you have some experience with identity space, you would know XACMEL is the de facto standard for defining authorization policies. But the adoption in XACMEL is not on the rise. It's still very less. Why is that? Is XACMEL dead? Not really. The problem I think many of the vendors made is that they expected the users would know the know to write XACMEL policies, know the XACMEL language, which was not the case. If you think about it, who defines authorization policies? Authorization policies are defined not by identity specialists. It's defined by business users, right? It's the line of business managers that would define authorization policies. So if you tell them to go and learn XACMEL or some other language for that matter, they would run away, right? You don't want to do that. So unless we give some good tools to enable the users to write good policies, the adoption of XACMEL would be less. But still, attribute-based access control is very widely used. Then segregation of duties and impact analysis are also two key features when it comes to authorization. Identity Server doesn't support it very well right now. For example, segregation of duties means, let's say there is a user who has the privilege or who has the permission to submit a claim as well as approve the claim, right? Then he can submit and he can approve it. So you don't want that to happen. So that is segregation of duties. And impact analysis, let's say you give a particular permission to a user, what are the resources that he can go and modify? If you remove it, what are the resources he won't be able to access? So that is impact analysis. So these are like already there in a couple of products. So these are not like very, very new things. So next is provisioning. How would you create users in a new system, right? Traditionally, there has been sharing, right? If you have experience with the current WSO2 products, you would see in a multi-product deployment, we need to share the user store, right? So that's a limitation. It's not practical anymore to share stuff, share user identities, right? Because now we are talking about distributed applications, going cross-domain. Sharing is not a possibility anymore. Then synchronization. This is another thing. It'll duplicate identities, of course. If you would have used Google, you would have known there's a Google LDAP sync tool, right? So that is an example for synchronization. But it's not a standard again, and it works with only with Google, and like not every system works with this synchronization tools. So the preferred approach is just-in-time provisioning, right? So what is just-in-time provisioning? So when you federate for a single sign-on, you go to another IDP, like Facebook or Google or whatever. You federate and you come back. And when the system identifies, in this picture, ISA, right? When it identifies that you're a new user, it can decide whether to provision your account to the local user store, or it can decide whether to even provision your account to another federated system, like ISB. Right, so that is just-in-time provisioning, and then there are also like complex rules that can be used to decide whether to provision you or not. For example, if the assertion, the identity assertion, tells you that this user is in this particular role, only then I need to provision. Otherwise, I don't need to provision. I just need to send the assertion back. So that is like rule-based provisioning, right? So those are some complex stuff. Then delegated access control. So when we talk about delegated access control, the first thing comes to mind is OAuth. So I think if you're dealing with REST APIs and stuff, you're already familiar with OAuth. I'm not going to talk about OAuth. But then there is this new standard called UMA, right? So what's the difference between OAuth and UMA? In OAuth, the purpose of OAuth is to give access. Now, if I'm the resource owner in that picture, the circle in the right on the top, if I'm the resource owner, I'm giving certain privileges to a client application, to my mobile phone, to the application that is running on my client, and say, you can access my resources within this time period, and you can do only these operations. So that is giving certain privileges to a client application. But then UMA introduces a new party, which is the circle on the right-hand side, the requesting party, which is a human being, actually. So the same thing, you're delegating some privileges to another human being, actually, for a limited time, maybe, right? A good use case is, say you are a very senior manager, right? You're going on vacation, right? You want to delegate some of your privileges to a subordinate, right? So that's a use case, right? We come up with these requirements very often when we meet customers. Like, earlier there was no standard for this. So UMA, this is what it tries to solve, right? It's a common use case. Then workflows, right? So we want to be able to engage some orchestration process for any identity operation, right? So let it be adding users, assigning roles to users. So we want to engage some orchestration process, right? So we introduced workflow capability in IS510. So this is kind of the architecture, but there are three key extension points for the workflow feature. So one is the Identity Server 510 connects with the WSO2 BPS product by default. But if you have a different BPS product, then you can write a connector and plug it in. On the other hand, it supports by default all the user store operations like adding users, assigning roles to users. So whenever you do that, there will be a workflow triggered, and there can be a human task where another user will come and, you know, approve the task, and then only the user would be actually created in the user store. So you can extend that to other operations as well, like when you're defining policies or when you're publishing policies, those also you can engage workflows by extension. And the third extension is a very important extension that is called templates, right? So I was talking about Zacmel and the mistake that we made in Zacmel. We expected the users would know to write Zacmel policies, right? So we didn't make that mistake here. We didn't assume that the users would know to write BPL processes or human task processes, right? We assumed users will have zero knowledge. So what we gave was a template-based approach, right? So we gave a default template, which is a multi-step, multi-option template, right? So if you're engaging a workflow for a particular operation, first you need to create an instance of that template, right? So let's say I create an instance saying, okay, my workflow has three steps. The first step needs to be approved by HR admin, a user in HR admin role. Second step needs to be approved by a specific user, giving the username. And the third step should be approved by a person in another role, something like that, right? So you can define concrete workflows with any number of steps and any number of options, and then deploy your BPL process. So the user doesn't need to have any BPL knowledge. He doesn't even need to log into the BPS product. So that's the advantage we give with our workflow feature. And then identity analytics. So if you have been to the talks in the morning, you would know that we are putting a lot of effort on this analytics space. So even the product strategies are changing. Like, we are going to release a separate analytics product for each of the other products. Like, so we would have analytics for identity product. So the key areas that we cover would be the authentication analytics, so login attempts, login failures, and the geo distribution of the login attempts. Then the authorization analytics, right? What resources were accessed the most, right? And if there are failures, what are the resources that were denied the most? And then we can give more drilled down details of those authorization failures. Then audit trails are a very important thing when it comes to identity, right? If you give a particular identity entity in the IAM system, you should be able to draw out the complete life cycle of that identity. Say a user, you give a username, you should be able to draw out the full history of the user from the time he was provisioned to what roles were assigned, what permissions were assigned, when he was deprovisioned, when his account got locked, unlocked, the full history should be there. So that is called audit trail. So it's not only for users, you can have it for roles, you can have it for any other entities like devices and so on. So eventually what we want to get to is a solution like SIM, right? So But what I would say is we have the bits and pieces, the nuts and bolts to build such a solution. We have the WSO2 DAS product. We have the complex event processing product for intrusion detection and intrusion prevention kind of things. Then we have the machine learner product to learn new anomalies and learn new kind of algorithms and detect frauds. So we have the nuts and bolts that are required. So this is where we want to eventually arrive at. Then another important component when it comes to an IAM system is a self-service portal. So any system should have a self-service portal for the end users themselves to go and log in and do their own operations, like updating their profiles, updating their social login accounts, revoking access to authorized applications, like I was talking about in OAuth. And then if you are an administrator and you have some pending approvals, like in the workflow feature, then you should be able to go and approve those workflows. So that's like a self-service portal. So these are some of the key features in an IAM system. Then we introduced this concept called Enterprise Identity Bus. So what we actually realized was the problem in identity is very similar to the problem in ESB, right? What does an ESB try to do? It tries to connect heterogeneous systems that are talking different protocols together, right? The same problem is there with identity. We are trying to connect disparate systems that are talking different identity protocols, communicating different identity assertions together. And the dream of having a single identity standard is not a reality anymore. People are every day coming up with new things. And there are a lot of legacy systems we need to integrate. So the story is quite similar to a ESB. And also, we need to separate the identity layer from the application layer. So this is the real motivation to come up with an enterprise identity bus. We actually introduced this concept with IS50 release way back in 2014. And this is kind of the architecture. So there are several plug points in this architecture. You can have inbound authentication connectors. You can have outbound authentication connectors, inbound provisioning connectors, outbound provisioning connectors, user store managers, and stuff like that. So there are, if you go to that link down there, you can find more details of the architecture. So these are the requirements of an ESB. These are the real motivation behind why we need an EIB. So I was talking about this stuff. So federation protocol agnostic, right? The protocol that the identity provider can talk and the protocol the service provider can talk should not be of real concern, right? And authentication protocol agnostic. Once you go to the identity server, how you authenticate should not really matter, right? You can use first factor authentication, two factor authentication, whatever the mechanism may be, that should be irrelevant for the service provider, right? Then complex authentication requirements, like I was talking about, the adaptive authentication, step-up authentication. So these are very complex authentication requirements. Right now, even in IS50, these adaptive or step-up authentication features are not there at the moment. Then trust brokering, right? The service provider should be able to say explicitly, these are the identity providers I want to trust. I don't want to trust anybody else, right? Then manage identity relationships, right? I was talking about a single user can have multiple personas. That was the user-centric identity. But you need to manage the relationships, right? So if a user is coming from Facebook, there needs to be mapping between that user and the user in your user store. So that's a relationship. And also, like, a single user can have multiple accounts over time. There could have been multiple accounts that have been created by different departments of the organization. And then you need to, merge them together. So that is local account mapping, sort of. And then claim transformation. So this is also a very important requirement when it comes to an identity bus, right? Claim mapping. So the claim URIs, like you find in SAML or OpenID Connect, the claim URIs are different. The service provider might use a different URI to identify claims. The identity provider might use a different URI. So you need to do claim URI mapping, right? Then claim aggregation. For example, say the service provider is requesting the full name of the user, but in the IAM system, you only have the first name and the last name. Then you need to aggregate them together and give the full name, right? Or claim derivation, right? The service provider, for example, is requesting your age, but what you have in the identity server is the date of birth of the user. So from the date of birth, you can derive the age of the user. So these are some claim requirements. Then, of course, authorization policies, you know, using ZACBL or some other authorization policy language. And then provisioning, the JIT provisioning, rule-based provisioning, which I was talking about. And then centralized administration and monitoring. So these are some of the key requirements when it comes to an enterprise identity bus. And these are not just requirements that we have found. If you go to any of the, you know, analyst papers like Gartner, Forrester, Kuppinger, Cole. If you go to those papers, you can see at least there's a subset of these you know, common identity bus problems. So these are quite common. So another lesson that we learned from ESB is that it's very difficult to define such complex identity federation rules, right? So another idea that sparked up was, why don't we come up with a domain-specific language to define such complex identity federation rules? So like, for example, the ESB has Synapse, which is a domain-specific language to write transformation rules. So likewise, we can have a similar thing for identity server. So this is still at a very theoretical, conceptual level, nothing materialized as yet, but this is something we have in mind. And if we can provide tools on top of this to easily build it, that will be really cool, right? Making sure the users don't need to learn any domain-specific languages, right? So this is like the proposed architecture, still what's on paper. Then the extensibility of the product, right? So if you would have used the identity server in your organizations, you would know that there are a lot of extensions in the product. So authenticator is an extension point. A provisioning connector is an extension point. So it's all Java-based, and you can easily implement an interface and plug in extension. And not only the runtime is extensible, it's very important to make the UI also extensible, right? So the thing is, when you write and drop in an authenticator, even the UIs get automatically populated, right? So that's also important, right? So the plan for the future is to make the identity server core more and more leaner, and to make everything a set of pluggable connectors, right? Like I was talking, that makes us, release features more rapidly, upgrade the product more rapidly, which is not the case right now, okay? And of course, when we have that capability, the next thing that eventually comes would be the requirement for a connector store, right? You go to any major identity vendor, they have a store to write and plug in connectors. So we have released a set of connectors in the WSO2 public store. Earlier, it was only available for ESP connectors. Now there are a set of IS connectors as well. So plan is to write more connectors, open the throttle, and complete around 50 to 60 connectors by end of the year. So that's the plan. So that's the end of my talk. If there are any questions related to any of these, I can answer.